Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of the town council.
Of the town council.
And now if we could have Charles Greer come forward, and he is going to be sworn in to the Cape Elizabeth School Committee.
I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And will obey the laws.
And will obey the laws.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And of the state of Maine.
And of the state of Maine.
That I will.
That I will.
In all respects.
In all respects.
Observe the provisions.
Observe the provisions.
Of the charter and ordinances.
Of the charter and the ordinances.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And statutes of the state of Maine.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Of the Cape Elizabeth School.
Of the Cape Elizabeth School Board.
Congratulations to one and all. We're now going to start the agenda. As we always do, we'll start by having the town clerk call the roll.
Frank Littori.
Present.
Jane Amaro.
Here.
Phyllis Cogsall.
Here.
Wayne Krillman.
Here.
Janet Greenlaw.
Here.
William Jordan.
Yeah.
Nancy Masterton.
Here.
Thank you. We have before us two packets of minutes. One is for the meeting held on May 8, 1989. The second packet of minutes is for the meeting held on May 22, 1989. Someone would care to move adoption?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any amendments? If not, all those in favor? Any opposed? Passes unanimously. This is the time that we put aside for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. If there are any citizens that would like to come forward at this time, traditionally we have a time set aside at the beginning and one set aside at the end of each meeting for citizens that wish to bring forward any items that they may have not addressed on our agenda. Any citizens care to come forward to make such a presentation? If not, I would move on to a proclamation that we have here, and I'm wondering if we have one of two people, either Frank Miles or Nancy Siegel, in the audience. Oh, okay.
Frank Miles.
Oh, very good. I'm now going to make a presentation for you.
I'd really like to have these three students who are on the speech and debate team join me.
Very good. Yeah.
Would you three come forward? We have with us Chris Lynn, Alex Metzger, and Lori Rubin, all of whom are juniors at Cape Elizabeth High School and members of the speech and debate team.
Very good. What I have here is a presentation of a resolution for everyone, and it reads, Cape Elizabeth Town Council Resolution. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth High School speech and debate team recently won their state championship competition, whereas extemporaneous speaking skills is a skill that may be utilized throughout one's lifetime, whereas the learning of debating techniques has the potential of enriching our democracy, whereas the achievement in winning the state championship in speech and debate is deserving of recognition from the entire Cape Elizabeth community, now therefore be it resolved that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby salute the Cape Elizabeth High School speech and debate team and their coach, and we thank them all for representing our community so well. So here's a presentation to you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Now it's time on the agenda for reports and correspondence, and I would ask if any of my fellow councilors have any reports that they'd like to bring forward. Yes, Councilor Krill.
Well, just to continue some of the kudos, in addition to the speech and debate team achievements this year, we have a variety of Cape Elizabeth athletes who have excelled, and I'd like to bring a particular recognition to them. Firstly, with regard to the high school tennis team, the Cape Elizabeth boys again took the Class B state tennis championship, continuing their incredible unbeaten streak. And in particular, of the team, two individuals have been selected by the Telegram All-State Tennis Team. And these are Bill Brown, assigned to the first team, and John Siminski, assigned to the second team. Secondly, I'd like to take this opportunity to, again, give a kudo to an individual on the Telegram All-Star Track Team. She is Angela DeGeorge in the 400, who has also excelled on the athletic field. I will lastly mention another part of our athletic team, and that is the coaches, who recently the Telegram noted that 19 main coaches were among 3,297 United States coaches to win Franklin Select Circle Coaching Awards. And of those 19, three are from Cape Elizabeth High School. Paul Jackson, cross-country coach, won the gold award. Donald Richards won the gold award in swimming. And Andrew Strout won the silver award for tennis. And now I will defer the last section of kudos to my fellow counselor regarding the lacrosse team.
Since I have somewhat a vested interest in the lacrosse team, we had the first public school to place in the lacrosse first state championship. This was Cape Elizabeth finished second against Hyde. It was a very exciting season. We have the Telegram All-Star Lacrosse Team with the defense of Chris Carlisle and Troy Graham. Midfield was Peter Sanger, and John Prince was the attack. And these are all public school students, as you know. But we also had Chris Carlisle, who is selected to be on the U.S. All-Star Lacrosse Team, as well as Coach Charlie Birch being selected to be one of the coaches that played at John Hopkins this past week.
Very good. Thank you. Other reports and correspondence now from anyone? Yes, Councilor Amber.
I'd just like to report to the full council on a briefing that was held on June 8th on a possible site for demolition materials. And the briefing was co-sponsored by Regional Waste Systems and COG. As you know, COG has been looking for sites for close to 2 years now. A site has become available in Gorham, an over 200-acre site, and RWS has purchased a six-month option on that land. So there is a need now to fast-track the process if that piece of land is the property that's going to be used. So the briefing brought us up to date on what needs to happen now in order to make that a reality. And the first thing that needs to happen is that we need to appoint two people from Cape Elizabeth to attend a meeting on June 21st regarding this whole issue and to ask questions to protect the town's interests. And the date, final date for us having to make a decision as to whether we want to be part of this new authority, which will be similar to Regional Waste Systems, but will be a new authority constituted of communities interested in participating in this regional waste site. We will need to make a decision on whether we're going to participate or not by August 15th. So this is really fast-tracking this item. I'd like to have somebody show an interest in being able to attend that meeting on June 21st. Nancy, you would be willing to do it?
What time? Tell me later.
I don't know yet what time is. I don't think the time's been set. But Michael, would you be able to go too? You would not.
Maybe this one.
Is there a possibility that Lester might be able to attend?
Yeah, he might be able to. I don't know. I could check, but he would be a good person to participate on that. And then one other item Just a reminder that June 22nd is the COG annual celebration of all the good work that local public officials do, and I hope that everybody will attend, and that is one meeting where spouses are also invited to attend, too. It's a real fun, fun evening.
Just if any of you are going, you could let me know at the end of the meeting, and I'll send in the reservations.
Okay. Counselor Cogswell?
I also want to congratulate Counselor Jane Amaro on being elected to the presidency of the COG organization, and she'll be installed at this particular banquet. Is that correct?
Very good. I think attendance will be fairly high from our board. I have a feeling.
I think we should give her a round of applause.
Okay, any other reports and correspondence? Because if not, go right ahead.
I would just like to report, and probably you all read in the paper a little bit, about the status of the jail committee, and they do have a site in Portland, or possibly two sites, and they still have the Ross Grant site available if they want to proceed there in the future. And Peter Manning, Representative Manning, has put a bill in the legislature to authorize us to have a referendum in November, and by August 15th, the committee's got to choose whether it's going to be Gorham or Portland, but they have until August to decide whether it's going to be Gorham or Portland, and that's the way the bill is going to read, with the option of Portland or Gorham. It got down to the wire as far as the bill goes. The final reading of the bill, he had a tentatively introduced to have it on the agenda at this session. So, and it's going to be possibly around a 300-bed facility, and it's going to be in the neighborhood. There'll be other figures coming out, but it's going to be in the neighborhood of $22-23 million.
It's quite a neighborhood. Okay, thank you. Thank you for that report. Yes, Michael?
Yeah, just wanted to mention to the council, some of you may have noticed in Friday night's Evening Express an article about the dog ordinance and a position purportedly taken by the ordinance committee. If you, any of you who are on the ordinance committee and read that would wonder where the information came from. We had given the reporter a copy of the proposal, and that is what was printed. It was totally inaccurate, the article, in terms of the ordinance committee's position. And, you know, I think it's unfortunate anyone who read that might think that that was the ordinance committee's position. Chief Pickering, who was the other contact with the reporter, tried to reach her today and was unable to, and is going to try to talk to her tomorrow to get the issue squared away. But for those of you who did read it and serve on the ordinance committee, you realize it wasn't very close to the position that you have.
I agree with that.
Mm-hmm. It's too bad they put it on the front page.
Mr. Chairman, now he's onto the press. There's one thing that I read in the paper that I didn't agree with, and that's a town line. I don't think everybody in Cape Elizabeth realized the line was in the river. In the past, I think there was at least one resident of the town, if not more, that realized that the line went on a straight line. So they make errors, and I just wanted to point it out.
And we clarify them here. Good. The only thing I wanted to add was, once again, thanking everybody involved with the Memorial Day Parade. It was just an outstanding from beginning to end in terms of the organizers, the participants, the onlookers. It was, I think all of us that attended on behalf of the council had an excellent time, but more importantly, we're glad to see an important tradition revived with that much enthusiasm. So on behalf of all the hard work, I know there was a committee, people worked hard, and 6 months or so or more even in the planning, and it was very, very successful. So thank you to everybody in town that was involved one way or another. If there's no further discussion, I'd like to move on to item number one, which is to consider the election of a town council chairman and take any necessary action. Yes, Councilor Greenwald.
Frank, it's with great pleasure that I would like to put forth a nomination for our next town council chairman. Men and women of the council, my nomination for the chair is a man who served us well here, there, and everywhere. He's been known to put out fires, run our budgets, plow some snow. On the Wells Road, he's the berries. There's no produce he can't grow. So, men and women of the council, my nomination, if you will, to keep the Cape all green and growing, for chairman, we need Farmer Bill.
Second.
I'll second.
Is this where the balloons drop? I don't want to miss my cue. All right, it has been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Farmer Bill?
Farmer Bill passes unanimously, 7-0. At which point I will take my leave, as they say.
Just don't walk too far away. Bob Frank, I enjoyed you for the year, and even though I didn't always agree with you, there's one thing I noticed, that I won't have a full head of hair to show to the people while we're here in front of the camera so much, but any chance I can get the camera going your direction, I certainly appreciate working for you. Here's a little something for you. You're the first to start with the gavel, I think, and really use it hard. So yeah.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. I would like to say one thing before I depart. As I officially hand over to the gavel. In all seriousness, we've had some heavy meetings, we've had some fun, but I want to express my deep appreciation to my fellow councilors for their support and for their active participation in every meeting. You've always come so well prepared, so willing and enthused to discuss the issues of the town, that it's absolutely a pleasure to be chairman of this council. And I'd also like to thank Michael and Deborah as well for their incredible professionalism. It's really been one of the highlights of my public life, being chairman, and I've just enjoyed it and enjoyed working with you. You've been very special. Thank you very much. William, use it wisely.
Before we move on to the official part of the agenda and continue along, is there's a couple of things I'd like to say that I would like to see moved on this year. And as Frank told me, to make sure I had a real good speech, you have to do that now when you take over here. There's one thing that I'd like to do and have this council do is to set up a committee, and I'll have an item on the agenda at the next council meeting. I would like to have a committee or any volunteers to work on a war memorial for the town of Cape Elizabeth, similar to what used to be here in the past. The one in the past was a wooden one, but I think if we come up with a new modern granite type monument, would it be great, and have every veteran of all wars and conflicts names inscribed on it. And I don't know where it would go, but I'd like to have a committee of whatever the council agrees, whether 5, 7 or what have you. It all depends how many volunteers, and to move forward on that. There's a few things I'd like to see move forward this year, and possibly we could get it finished before the year's out, and that's what we're going to do as far as the Jordan Trust in the town farm, and to get it nailed down in what direction we should go. And also the comprehensive planning committee, I would like to move that forward and get that completed this year if it's all possible. And the affordable housing, but the way the numbers sound in Augusta, it doesn't look so the affordable housing will move forward that as fast as I had hoped it would be, and I think also members of this this council had hoped it would be. But I think if we can still prod it along, maybe we can come up with something. And last, I'd like to see some changes in the sewer ordinance, because I think that we should use our sewer treatment plants to capacity and not continue to put this effluent into the ground. There's a project on Mitchell Road that's come to my attention in the last week, and I see we have received a letter on tonight on the table here of a project on Mitchell Road where the ones on the road go into the sewer and the ones in the backland have to have a leaching area. And I feel what you're doing there in time is sending your influent down into your wetlands, which you're trying to save, and I don't think that is the direction the Cape should be heading. So I would hope that we could move something in a direction to try to correct some of those things. That will be part of the project, and I'll try to keep law and order, council agendas, and not let people get too upset. So we'll move on to item two. Consider the adoption of the town council rules and take any necessary action.
I move adoption of the council rules.
Second.
Any questions? Go ahead.
On section 12 of the rules, it calls for a reading of the minutes at each meeting. That's something that I don't think has ever been done, at least not since I've been on the council. So I'd like to recommend that that be stricken from the rules. I don't think any of us want to have the minutes read. I have to vote every single time on suspending the rules.
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
The same thought occurred to me as I was rereading these rules. However, there is a section that deals with dispensing of the reading of an especially long or complicated ordinance, and in reflection, I thought that that would take care of the reading of the minutes, and there's something about reading something by title only. Don't you think that that takes care of the minutes? We should dispense with the reading
right.
of the minutes.
Dispense with the reading.
Yeah.
That's what we have to do to comply with these rules.
But we could get at it that way.
Councilor Greenwood.
Well, what we actually in practice usually do is accept the minutes after we've all reviewed them. Is it possible to officially change Section 12 in order to instead read the minutes of the preceding meeting to be accepted and proceed to business rather than read, with the assumption that they are read before acceptance?
Excuse me.
It seems to me if we do that, we have to include something that allows us to amend the minutes as well, rather than saying we're going to accept them, or accept them as amended, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. I'd have no problem with that, with that clause, if we can get that written in.
I think maybe we should rewrite that section so we wouldn't run into that every time, whether we have to amend the rules or whatever. Anybody else? Other comments? Council.
I guess that I'd move that we bring these back for consideration next month with an amended version of Section 12 to reflect the way we really do operate.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment?
Does that mean that presently the rules are in effect as they? These are presently the rules in effect then, so. Okay, yes. But we're going to be changing them. I just wanted to make sure we weren't suspending all rules.
No, we're not suspending anything.
With me on
anything.
The council, that wouldn't be a good idea, would it? No. I'm just kidding.
Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? That's a vote, 7-1. Item 3. To consider the appointments of a finance committee and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, it is also with great pleasure that I would like to at this time nominate my fellow councilors to serve as a committee of the whole on the finance committee, and to have as chairman of that committee a councilor who has served our town very well in many capacities and has done an outstanding job on her time as on the town council, Councilor Phyllis Cogsall.
Second.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
You'll get the second. All in favor? Those opposed? 7-0.
I would have written a longer one, Phyllis. I didn't know Janet was going to do that. I'll make it up to you. Yeah, rhyme. I'm good at rhyme.
Item 4, to consider the appointment of an appointments committee and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, I nominate Janet Greenlaw as chairman and Frank Latore and Jane Amaro as members of the appointments committee.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All in favor? Raise your hand.
Oh, yeah, I can vote.
Sure, you can. Okay. 7-0, okay. To consider the, item 5, to consider the appointments of an ordinance committee and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
I did not have the benefit of former Councilor Bill Wadman to help me with this one. For the ordinance committee, I would like to nominate as chair Wayne Creelman and as members Phyllis Coggeshall and Nancy Masterton.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? See how easy it is? Item 6, to consider the election of a representative to serve on the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee and the General Assembly and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead.
In order for her to continue the excellent work that she has given over several years to the Greater Portland Council of Governments, and secondly, so that she may assume its presidency, I'd like to nominate Councilor Amaro to the Executive Committee of the Greater Portland Council of Governments.
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 7, to consider the appointment.
Excuse me, but there should be two people nominated to the General Assembly also.
That's a separate item.
Part 2.
I thought it was a separate deal. Excuse me. I'm sorry. And the General Assembly.
All right.
Okay.
So, Mr. Chairman, I would nominate Phyllis Coggeshall and Wayne Creelman to be representatives in the COG General Assembly, and our town manager, Michael McGovern, to be as alternate.
Do I hear a second to that?
Second.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. Item 7, to consider the appointment of a council representative to serve on the Regional Waste System Board of Directors and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate for this position Lester Jordan. Lester has been serving on the Regional Waste Systems Board since its inception, has done an excellent job, is presently vice president of that organization, and is extremely involved in the new demolition site proposal. So it's with a great deal of pleasure that I nominate Lester Jordan as our representative and Michael McGovern as an alternate to the RWS board.
I'll second.
All in favor? Those opposed? Item 8, to consider the appointment of the PACS Policy Committee and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, despite our recommendation to the town manager to not be on as many boards as he is on, I would like to, with great pride, nominate Michael McGovern, our town manager, to be our PACS Policy Committee representative.
Second.
All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Okay. Item 9, to consider the authorization of a certain year-end transfer between the accounts and take any necessary action. I'll turn that to the manager.
The charter provides that during the last, I believe it's 3 months of the fiscal year, the council can revise certain appropriations for accounts that are projected to have balances at the end of the year that are in a negative situation. This particular year, sort of pleased to report we only have 3 accounts, but I'm not pleased to report that the revisions are substantial. The accounts are administration professional services from $30,000 original appropriation to $50,000, employee benefits from $105,000 to $130,000, and general assistance from $8,000 to $12,000. The professional services account, as you can see, is over primarily because of legal fees. As of May 18th, it was only up to $36,820, but we do expect substantial legal bills for the months of May and June, and we'll expect almost up to the $50,000. Employee benefits was over budget due to a 41.8% increase in health insurance rates when we had only budgeted 8%. And the general assistance or welfare account is simply up due to more clients coming in and a greater cost per client.
Yes.
Michael, where does this additional money come from? What account?
It's from miscellaneous savings in a whole bunch of accounts.
No problems?
No, no. We're doing very well with revenues at this point, particularly in investment income.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
So what you're saying is the bottom line that we dealt with at budget is not changing?
It's improving slightly.
Okay. Anyone else? Do I hear a motion?
I move to accept the revised appropriations as listed here on our sheet.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Everyone understand the motion? Mm-hmm. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Move. Item 10, to consider authorization certain carry forward balances and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
The list is before you. Would you like me to go through it?
Briefly.
Yes.
Briefly?
Yes.
Okay. The again, this relates to a provision in the charter. The charter provides that any project that was funded that is not yet completed automatically carries forward. Some of these, it's debatable whether or not it's a project that isn't done, or so, you know, I bring all of them before you, even the ones that are automatic. The street opening account is by state law that does need to be carried forward. The land acquisition fund, for the first time, does include some interest. The council voted about a year ago that henceforth the balance in that account would accrue interest. The library gift account is self-explanatory. The library copier is a one that's been set up for a very long time, and it's primarily used by the public, the copier at the library, and the revenues stay in an account so that we never have to budget for the replacement of a copier. It continuously provides for a new one. The Thomas Jordan Trust, that's from revenue primarily from the Portland Water District for lease for the treatment plant site, and we're still trying to determine whether or not the treatment plant is in fact on that site. The Gladys Brown Fund is from funds that the late Gladys Brown left to the town. It was actually much more than this. This is the balance left. Working with a new tree warden, who you'll hopefully confirm or appoint later tonight, I believe we'll during the next year we'll have an aggressive planting program and utilize those funds. The comprehensive plan, this carry forward account is as well as this and the Willowbrook Dam are projections of what it will cost to finish them, more than indicating that those are the balances that are left. The comprehensive plan balance is substantially less than that, but I have spoken with the planner regarding it, and this is our projection what it would cost to complete it, similarly with the Willowbrook Dam. The Sawyer Road project, as mentioned in a memo to you, is just about done, and we will be closing that account within the next several months, and I'll give you a report on that at that time, on exactly where it's done. I have given you early reports with the budget. The refuse disposal equipment account was originally $25,000. It was voted 2 years ago. About $6,000 was spent on planning for our cost for the regional demolition site, some assessments that were made to us. The balance is $19,105. Before this money is spent, it would come back to you for specific authorization for either recycling or for perhaps if we're asked to contribute to this regional site, this would also be a source for the money. Fort Williams Memorial Gifts, those are gifts specifically giving for memorials. They are not the dollar fee that comes in for parking. Family Fund Day, whatever the present balance is at the end of the year. the town hall roof. This was funded in this year's budget. We decided to lump that money in with next year's appropriation so we can get all of the shingle part of the roof done this year. The tree account is the balance left in the tree account. I really think with the new tree warden, we'll be able to get a lot done in that regard. Fort Williams improvements is for Battery Blair. We opened bids on Thursday for Battery Blair and the bleachers. The successful bid was about $59,000. Between those two projects, we had a total of available of about $10,000 more than that. So it is hoped, as the original plan was, with the balance of that funds, we'll be able to do some landscaping around Battery Blair and really clean that area up and make it something we can be all proud of. The Goddard Mansion Stabilization Account, the amounts that have been appropriated for that over the years, and the road project account is whatever the account balance will be as of June 30. I'm not too sure what it will be.
Anybody got any comments?
Question.
Claude.
Michael, I feel that I have to ask this for Penny Carson, former Councillor Penny Carson. What are the plans? We have $11,216 in the Goddard Mansion Stabilization Account. What are the plans for further stabilization? Or are they? Was my understanding it was done.
It was, you know, first stabilized. There's always more work to be done on it. There's a spot where there's a granite crossbar that goes across that has may have insufficient support under it. There's additional waterproofing that can be done. General cleanup, you know, but beyond that, there aren't any specific plans.
Are we putting anything out to bid?
Currently, no.
Planning to do anything this summer?
No. When we went out to bid for the other Fort Williams work, that's all masonry work, waterproofing, et cetera, and we asked for all those costs on a unit basis. And one reason we did that is so that if the bids did come in favorably, we could look at other areas for improvements, as well as, like, for removing paint off certain bleachers, certain stone walls, there's a few spots at the fort that could be done, and we now have a firm price to do it. Similarly, we may look at the mansion and for that and see if the unit price could be taken over there to do a little bit of work there. But nothing major is planned.
Anybody else? I have one comment on the Sawyer Road project. Before you come in, I haven't seen my monument yet of the South Pole and Cape Elizabeth line. Yep. And I don't want to have to go through a line situation in the future, yep. So I'd like to see that monument replaced.
Bob Malley mentioned it to me last week that when he was talking to them at some point early last week, they indicated that they plan to do it this week. Time will tell.
Are they going to have to survey it and get it back in the right spot, or do they know about where it belongs?
They indicated to us that they had good markings on plans of exactly where it was with you know, from a certain baseline.
I'm watching.
Good. Let me know when it goes in.
Okay, you'll hear the report from the manager. What's your wishes?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that the council authorize the just enumerated carry forward balances.
I'll second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. Item number 11, to consider authorizing the town manager to file an application to the Maine Department of Environmental Protection for a sand dune permit to restore the sand around two catch basins at Casino Beach, take any necessary action. You've all had a note from the manager in your packet, and what's your wishes?
Mr. Chairman, I would move that the town manager is authorized to file an application with the Maine Department of Environmental Protection for a sand dune permit to restore sand around two catch basins at Casino Beach.
Second.
Do I hear a second? Any other questions? Any comments?
Yes, I have a question. Michael, do you have any idea how long it's going to take to get this permit?
The application indicated that it could take up to 60 days. I actually sent in the application in order to try to get that going on June 7th with a note to Deb Richard saying, please expedite this, the summer season is short. It's not something that was caused by the ocean, it was caused by water coming the other direction. I'm hopeful that she will address it. There's a minimum two-week period for public comment, and so once that goes by, I'll give them a call and see how it's coming along. But it's a very minor project in terms of environmental.
Well, I was hoping that it could be done this summer.
Mm. It will definitely be done this summer.
Any other comment?
I just wanted to ask if there's anything we need to do to prevent this from happening again. If the storm drain overflow, does it need to be cleaned out? Do we need to do anything there?
I think it was simply a situation that the flows during that storm were so tremendous that the pipe wouldn't handle them. The force of water was such that it would have cleaned itself out. Instead of lifting up the catch basin cover, as what happened, the only way to resolve a problem like that is to put in a larger pipe, and that would take, of course, a substantial cost, a substantial amount of time, and environmentally, whenever you put a pipe through sand into the ocean, and that would be a much more complicated permitting process. We don't have any plans to do that. The pipe served well for years and years, and this is the first known instance of this
happening.
That
was an exceptional storm.
It was.
Anybody else? All set?
Mm-hmm.
All in favor? Raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 12, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding vacancies on town boards and commissions and taking necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Ammer.
This is my last official act as chairman of the Appointments Committee, and I'm pleased to report with the three people whose names I'm bringing forward to you tonight. If you do vote to accept their nominations, we will have no vacancies on any committees in Cape Elizabeth. The first recommendation is Jane Sneerson of Salt Spray Lane to fill the unexpired term of Alan Wicken on the Arts Commission. Jane is a new citizen of Cape Elizabeth and has a strong background in art. So we're really pleased to be able to put forward her name. Secondly, Lee Chase of Ocean House Road to fill the unexpired term of Randall Weil on the Cable TV Advisory Board. And Lee is presently working right back there in our control booth and has been a very faithful volunteer on the technical side of Cable TV and operating the cameras, et cetera. And we're really pleased that he's agreed to serve on this board. Brings a lot of expertise with him. And the third nomination is of John Perry of Katahdin Road to fill the unexpired term of Steve Etzel on the Board of Sewer Appeals. And I'm really particularly happy to have John Perry agree to serve on this committee because he was on the Sewer Advisory Committee 3 or 4 years ago, and he will be the first person to serve on the Board of Sewer Appeals who actually had some experience with the Sewer Advisory Committee. So I'm really thrilled that he's agreed to serve on that committee. And with that, I put forward those nominations.
Second.
Do I hear a second? Anybody have comments? Anybody else? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed?
Mr. Chairman, I do have one question about the new Harbor Commission that is supposed to be established. Are we anywhere near filling those vacancies?
I have a number of people who have applied for that position, and we'll be turning these over to Janet at the end of the evening tonight and for action. So I would assume that this will be taken care of before the next meeting.
I'm very happy that Lee Chase's nomination passed so that we didn't go off the air, by the way. Lee, you're in.
I reviewed the Memorial Day parade, and I see that you and Lee Chase get along pretty well because you really blossomed out in the camera. They couldn't see poor old Farmer Bill on the other side. Item 13, to consider the appointments of a tree warden and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Once in a while, you go out and you advertise a position, and you get an applicant that is probably the very best person in the state that anyone could have for the position. And I think that's true in the case of our applicant for tree warden. Richard C. Churchill Jr. is the chairperson of the Plant and Soil Technology Department at Southern Maine Vocational Technical Institute. He has a master's degree in plant pathology and a doctorate in technical and adult education from the University of Florida. He's been in the landscaping business. He's been a curator of the Longfellow Arboretum. Did I pronounce that right?
Yes.
Good. Thank you.
Where is it?
It's in Payson Park in Portland. He's also been a horticultural consultant. He's a certified Maine nurseryman. He's done a comprehensive street tree plan for Saco, shade tree surveys for Portland and South Portland. He's helped put on a tree awareness program in our school system. He is the executive director of the Maine Nurserymen's Association. He's a director of the Maine Arborist Association. He's published a number of publications, including the Maine Arborist License Study Guide, several different versions of that. I could go on, but I'm very pleased to recommend him for appointment.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, I was approached by another individual showing interest in this position, and when he heard that Rick Churchill was applying, he said, "You've got the best person you could." I just want to echo what the manager said, and I would like to put into nomination the name of Richard Churchill as our tree warden.
Second.
Any other comment?
That would be effective July 1.
Effective July 1.
All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. Item 14, to consider the appointment of a director of emergency preparedness and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Just as Rick Churchill would replace an institution with Roy Maddox as tree warden, the nominee for director of civil emergency preparedness will replace an institution. Herb Chappell, as you know, has been the director of emergency preparedness, before that the director of civil defense, for over 26 years. Truly devoted service to Cape Elizabeth, and I hope that, you know, we can recognize him for his service, as well as Roy Maddox, at a future meeting. The nominee I bring before you tonight for the director of civil emergency preparedness is William Gregory Tinsman. Greg is a member of our fire department. He is also has been involved in our police department, a member of the water extrication team. He was a former member of the rescue unit, former public safety dispatcher, works full-time as a real estate broker. I think he brings an interesting perspective to the position in terms of the knowledge of the various public safety departments, as well as public works indirectly, which is very important. I also think that he will take civil defense in different directions. I think he'll bring a lot of energy to it, and he'll really look at the civil defense areas, the civil defense programs, and I'm sure we'll do an excellent job. And I recommend him highly for the position.
Yes.
I move that we appoint William Greg Tinsman as the director of the Emergency Preparedness Department.
Second. Moved and second.
Effective July
1. Effective July 1.
Effective July 1, 1989.
All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Oh, 7-0. Item 15, to consider the request from the Archangels Committee and take any necessary action. I believe you all received a letter from Soviet Senior Citizen, Soviet Sister City Committee of Greater Poland. Yeah, I wonder I didn't get something else mixed up there. Okay. Does anybody got any comments?
There's someone here to...
Somebody in the audience here is want to speak? Well, we have here Daniel Glover.
My name is Daniel Glover, right. I live in Westbrook, and I'm the president of the Archangel Committee. I have one thing to deliver, which is a document that was signed by Mr. McGovern, Mr. Latoy, which was, is the agreement that was signed between the Greater Portland Region and the City of Archangel in the first week of April. In 1987, I came to this council looking for endorsement of the concept of creating this relationship between Greater Portland and the City of Archangel. And after a rather long evening, I'm happy to see that things move on quickly tonight. You voted to support the idea, as did 10 other municipalities in the Greater Portland Region. Now we're in the process of coming back for money, which was one of the minor sticking questions at the time of the resolution being passed the last time I was here. And I think that we indicated that at some point in time we would be coming back looking for financial support. And our request this evening is that the town of Cape Elizabeth take membership in the Archangel Committee as a municipal member. We currently have one municipal member, that's the City of Westbrook. The town of Gorham has recently voted to fund the project as a member also. And we are pursuing the other municipalities. Two municipalities have declined membership, but that does not necessarily exclude them in participating in the functions and activities of the Archangel Committee. In November of 88, a delegation of four people, myself, Mayor Spiller, and two others, traveled to the City of Archangel. We signed an agreement. This is the countersigning that you have in front of you. And along with that agreement, there was an addendum to have four exchanges in 1989. The first one was a return delegation that we received in the first week of April. We received a delegation of four who did visit Cape Elizabeth. The second item was a high school exchange, which was successfully completed. 10 students from the Greater Portland Region, one is here this evening, Thomas Osborne Jr. We had 10 students from the Greater Portland Region travel to the City of Archangel for a month. As well, we had 10 students from the City of Archangel visiting the Greater Portland Region for a month. The third item that we agreed to was that we would each send representatives to a conference in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. And that conference has just been completed. Three people, Duke McKeel of Gorham and two others, attended on behalf of the Greater Portland Region and traveled from Tashkent back to the City of Archangel and then came home. And the fourth item on the agenda, or the fourth item of exchanges that we agreed to, was that they would be willing and ready to accept a delegation of tourists. And on June 17th, we have 43 people traveling to the City of Archangel, and this will be the first group of Americans to have visited this city since World War II. If you remember, the City of Archangel was a major port receiving Liberty ships having been built in South Portland. They were a major port receiving the Liberty ships and did receive a lot of Americans at that point in time. But since the war, the delegation of four were the first Americans that most of these people had ever seen. This group of 43 people will be the first real large group of Americans that most of these people from Archangel will have ever seen in their lives. I also brought along some pictures of the students that visited the Greater Portland Region. And while I'm passing these out, Tommy Osborne, if you will, would like to say a few words on behalf of the exchange that he participated in.
You could turn that mic over right over towards you.
I get to use this?
Yes.
Hello? All right. I'm Thomas Osborne, and I took part in the Archangel High School Exchange in April. Now, due to the efforts of Mr. Glover and the Archangel Committee, we were allowed to send 10 students from Greater Portland to the Soviet Union for an entire month. For the most part, we stayed in Archangel for 3 weeks. Well, in Archangel, we learn about the people and the culture. We stayed in the homes of some of the citizens of that city. And we established ties between their community and our community. And these are ties that we hope will continue. Next year, we hope Cape Elizabeth High School students will be able to go to Archangel. Mm-hmm. And right now, there are pen pals and things like that that have resulted from this Archangel committee. And so it's a good organization. It's helped us a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
What were your observations of Archangel?
Observations?
What impressed you the most? What
impressed me the most? Well, the people were very friendly there, and they liked Americans very much, and I was quite surprised about that, how friendly they were and how willing they were to be, to do this type of thing.
Has anybody else got any comments to either one of the gentlemen? What's your wishes?
Mr. Chairman?
Go ahead.
I'd like to recommend that we take $500 from the fiscal year 1989 budget from town council contingency in order to become a membership status with this organization.
I'll second the motion.
You'll second the motion? Been moved to second it. Does anybody else got any comment? Yes.
One thing that came to my attention over the weekend when I was having a conversation with a neighbor whom, unbeknownst to me, has signed up to go on this trip, and she informed me that there are 8 people from Cape Elizabeth, I believe, who are going on the trip starting this Saturday, some of whom were familiar names to me, some were not, and I think it's very special that we have that many people in Cape Elizabeth who have the interest and the wherewithal to be able to participate in this. I'm not pleased with the fact that this was an item that we had cut from the budget and the process we had used for that. My feeling, I guess I'm echoing Doug Tinsman in some respect, that if it was going to be in our budget, we should have put it in the budget. I do, however, feel this is a very worthwhile program, and I am going to vote in favor of this expenditure.
Anybody else?
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to read, I support this very strongly also, and I'd like to read very quickly from the mission of the Archangel Committee, which is to gather knowledge, develop understanding, and promote peaceful interaction between our two peoples. We seek to create opportunities for the citizens of Greater Portland and its Soviet counterpart to exchange ideas and to share the best qualities of our communities. And as I've told others in the community, I just feel that peace from our countries eventually will come grassroots from people to people, and this is an exact type of organization that fosters that, and I'm highly supportive of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Go ahead.
I just want to say that during the budget process, we didn't really have all the information we needed at that time to make a decision. We didn't have their budget, and also I agree with Janet that I like to vote for items during the budget process, but I think that this was unusual because we didn't have all of the information, so I plan to support this evening.
Anybody else? Everybody understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0.
Thank you for coming, both gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Did you get your pictures?
Yes.
Yes, he did.
You got all your
pictures. Nice, beautiful.
Beautiful pictures.
Okay, see you. Have a nice trip over.
Item 16, to consider the statutes. I'll hand man away and take any necessary action. Manager.
Yes, last month, after a lengthy executive session, you came out of executive session and you voted to give the Stewarts, who formerly owned the property at 10 Manor Way, until June 5th, 1989, to submit material indicating that they had a financing agreement to complete the property. At that meeting, Mr. Stewart was here and was aware of that condition. Since the May 22nd meeting, neither the town attorney nor I have heard anything from the Stewarts, either in writing or over the telephone. The second part of your vote at May 22nd was to give the Stewarts until August 1 to sell the property. In other words, to sell it to someone else so they would improve it. Or if that wasn't done, then the town would sell the property by tax deed. You know, unless I hear from you to the contrary, you know, unless you vote to the contrary tonight, I assume that the August 1 deadline still sticks, and we will send Mr. Stewart a letter by certified mail indicating that he has not complied with the deadline of June 5th and that he has until August 1 to sell the property.
Anybody got any comment?
Michael, you wouldn't move until after the deadline of the August deadline.
That's correct.
Would you? No. Do you
Anybody
want
else?
A motion?
Councilor Creamer.
I just have one question. Has there been any communication between the Stewart's attorney or the town manager or our town attorney? Has there been any communication at all?
We have not initiated any, to my knowledge, and Tom has not, to my knowledge, I haven't, and we have not heard from them either.
Michael, how were they notified of our actions? I'm sorry, through the chair. I'm not quite used to this yet.
I know.
In two manners. One, Mr. Stewart was here and heard it, and it was followed up with a letter sent by the town attorney to Mr. Stewart, which I believe you all received copies of prior to tonight.
Anybody else?
Proceed on course is my only comment.
You don't want a motion.
Just receive the report.
We don't need a motion.
We have an item here, number 16, and I think you should make a motion.
I move that we receive the manager's report. We have received the manager's report.
Thank you.
I second the reception.
Everybody understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? That's all the items that's on the agenda, and I'll assure you that all our council meetings from here on in will go beyond 1 hour.
Whoa, I can't wait to play this tape.
The next is citizens' discussions. Any citizens in the audience would like to have a few words with an item that was not on the agenda? If not, then I would entertain a motion for adjournment.
I so move
second.
That we adjourn.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All in favor? We will have a workshop after our adjournment, and it's working on council goals for 1990. Thank you.